All praise is due to Allah, Lord of all the worlds, and may the peace and blessings of Allah be upon His final prophet and messenger Muhammad, his family, his companions, and upon the righteous who follow their way until the last day. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, and welcome to Insight Audio Studios. I am Abu Muhammad al-Louisiani, and after thanking Allah, we are pleased to bring you our work entitled Islam for the New Shahaadah, Volume 1. This is done by our brother Abu Tasneem Dawud Adib. May Allah bless and preserve him and his family. The titles are as follows. Number 1, the Declaration of Faith. Number 2, the Articles of Faith. Number 3, the Categories of Tawheed. Number 4, the Pillars of Islam. Number 5, the Conditions of Prayer. Number 6, the Pillars of Prayer. Number 7, the Obligatory Aspects of Prayer. Number 8, the Sunan Aspects of Prayer. Number 9, the Obligatory Acts of Wudu, or Wet Ablution. Number 10, the Invalidators of Wudu. And number 11, the Ghusl, or the Purification Bath. We have engineered over 35 tracks in this work. So many topics have subtopics. We ask you to relax, listen, and take your notes. And now, Islam for the New Shahaadah, Volume 1, by Abu Tasneem Dawood Adib. You're listening to Insight Audio, Islamic audio for the world.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Insight Audio. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. In the name of Allah, the Beneficent, the Merciful, all praise is due to Allah, the Lord of the universe, the Beneficent, the Most Merciful, Master of the Day of Judgment. You alone do we worship, and you alone do we seek for aid and assistance. Guide us on the straight path, the path of those upon whom you have given your favors and blessings, not on the path of those who have received your anger, nor those who go astray. Welcome to Islam, for surely you have become successful. The purpose of this CD is simply to acquaint you, the listener, the new Muslim, with the basic teachings of al-Islam. What is intended here is to provide you with a proper insight into the subject of Islam and help you to appreciate the principles of al-Islam and what it stands for. So we are very pleased that you have accepted Islam. May Allah give you all the things that are good in this life and the next. And if you, my dear listener, are a non-Muslim and you are beginning to realize that Islam is the perfect religion chosen for you by Allah, we hope that Allah guides you and improves your condition. The Declaration of Iman, or Faith. To have knowledge of the meaning of the Declaration of Faith, which is the statement, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah, and to know the conditions of this statement, La ilaha illallah, is of an utmost importance. The meaning of the Declaration of Iman, or faith, is I bear witness that there is nothing worthy of worship as a deity except Allah, and I bear witness that Muhammad is the messenger of Allah. This beautiful statement that you've uttered enters you into Islam. That is, I bear witness that there's nothing worthy of worship as a deity except Allah, and I bear witness that Muhammad is the messenger of Allah. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. The shortened phrase can be said, la ilaha illallah. La ilaha illallah, there is nothing worthy of worship as a deity except Allah, is comprised of two parts. The first part, la ilaha, is a negation, meaning it negates the existence of all deities or anything that is worshipped besides Allah. While the phrase illallah, the second part of the entire phrase, is a confirmation. It confirms the right of lordship and godship and deity to Allah, who alone deserves to be worshipped. As for the conditions of this declaration, La ilaha illallah, then we will explain them to you in the second volume of this CD, inshallah, if it is the will of Allah. As for the articles of Iman, or faith, they are six. Number one, the belief in Allah. Number two, the belief in the angels. Number three, the belief in the divinely revealed scriptures or books. Number four, the belief in the prophets and messengers. Number five, the belief in the last day. And number six, the belief in divine preordainment, the good of it and the bad of it, the sweet of it and the bitter of it. As for the categories of Tawheed, which is the belief in the uniqueness and oneness of Allah, then this has three categories. The three categories or aspects of Tawheed is number one, Tawheed al-Rububiyyah, which can also be called Tawheed al-Rabb. Tawheed al-Rububiyyah, or Tawheed al-Rabb, is the belief in the oneness and uniqueness of Allah as the Lord, which means that Allah is the only one who creates. He's the only one that owns everything that he created, and he is the administrator of all the affairs of his creatures. In addition to this, it means that Allah is the organizer, the planner, the sustainer, the provider, the one who gives life, and the one who causes death. All of this is the first category of Tawheed, which is Tawheed al-Rububiyyah or Tawheed al-Rabb. Number two, Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah or Tawheed al-Ilah. This Tawheed is the belief of the oneness of Allah in terms of worship, which means that there is no one or nothing that deserves to be worshipped except Allah. If we wanted to understand these two types of Tawheed or categories of Tawheed, in other words, to make it more simplified for you, imagine an arrow going upward and an arrow going downward. Anything that is involving Tawheed al-Ilah or Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah signifies the arrow going upward. In other words, the creature, the human being whom Allah has created to worship him, he bears witness that the prayers that he prays is only for Allah, and the fasting that he does is only for Allah. and the charity that he spends from his wealth is only for Allah. And all of the acts of worship are only for Allah. So that arrow extends from the creatures who are on earth up to Allah. So uluhiyah can always be remembered as or understood as going upward, meaning those acts of worship are going up to Allah. As for tawheed al-rububiyyah, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah the glorified and exalted is He, is the one, as we've mentioned, who is the creator. He is the sustainer. He is the organizer. He's the owner. So those things are coming from Him down to us. So simply, rububiyyah is anything coming from Him down to us, and uluhiyyah is anything that is coming from us up to Him. As for the third category of tawheed, and there is no fourth, then tawheed al-asma' was-sifat. Don't worry, you'll be able to pronounce these things very soon, if it's the will of Allah. Tawheed al-asma' was-sifat is the belief in the uniqueness of the most beautiful names and perfect qualities or attributes of Allah. You and I, as Muslims, may Allah bless you, must believe in all of Allah's beautiful names, His perfect attributes, His lofty qualities, His sublime characteristics, and no one can be named or given Allah's attributes except for Him. You and I also have to believe, affirm, and confirm all of Allah's attributes, which He Himself has called Himself and described Himself by in His book called the Quran, and also from the tongue of His final messenger and prophet, Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, may the peace and blessings of Allah be upon him. We are not allowed, you and I, to change the meanings of these names, to negate the meanings of these names and attributes, to twist their meanings, to give them any similarities between He Himself nor those whom He has created, nor to ignore them. They're only due to Him, they belong to Him only, and there is none like Him. As for the pillars of Islam, then they are five. That is, Islam is based or built upon five pillars. The first pillar is the bearing witness that no one, nothing, has the right to be worshipped except Allah, and that Muhammad is the messenger of Allah. We've already recited this for you, and as we said, don't worry, you'll be able to pronounce it soon. Repeat after me. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. That was very good. The second pillar, to offer the five obligatory formal prayers every single day. Number three, the third pillar, to pay the zakah, or the mandatory or compulsory charity. The fourth pillar of al-Islam is to perform the fast, to observe fasting during the ninth month of the Islamic calendar, which is called Ramadan. Once again, it's called Ramadan. And the fifth and final pillar of al-Islam is to perform the Hajj, which is the pilgrimage to the city of Mecca, which is found in the country of Saudi Arabia. And this is for those who can afford it financially and are physically able to perform it. The conditions of salah or prayer. The conditions of prayer in Islam are 9. They are as follows. Number 1, al-Islaam. That is, being a Muslim. That is a condition for prayer. Number 2, al-Aql, which is sanity. The person has to be in his or her right mind. The third condition of salah or prayer is at tamyiz, which is discernment. That is, the person has to be at the age where they can distinguish this from that, meaning right from wrong. The fourth, raf'ul hadath, the lifting or removal of those impurities that come from the two holes or orifices in your body. That is, from the front when you urinate and from the back when you defecate. The fifth one, izalatun najasa, which is the removal of impurities that are on the outside of your body, like urine and dung that may fall on your clothes or in the place that you're going to perform this salah or this prayer. Number 6, satrul awra, which is covering those parts of the body that Allah, through the legislation of the Quran and the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, may the peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, has explained to us what are those parts of the body, private parts of the body, that must be covered when you are performing the prayer. Number 7, دخول الوقت, the actual time of the prayer when it begins, meaning you cannot pray or perform a prayer before its time. This is the condition. Number 8, استقبال القبلة, meaning facing the direction of the prayer. This does not mean facing the east, as many people think, because the qibla, or the direction of the prayer for the Muslim, differs from one place to another in the world. The most important thing is that you must face the city of Mecca. Independent upon where you are living, it may not be the east. It may be northeast. It may be southwest. And finally, number 9, an-niyya. An-niyya is a condition for salah or prayer, which is intention. You must intend to perform this prayer not to gain a reputation, not to be seen by people when you're doing it, not for money or anything else. You must perform this prayer only for Allah. And this intention stems from your heart, and it is not done with the tongue. As for the pillars of salah, or prayer, then they are 14. Number 1, if you have the ability to do so, then you have to stand when you're making the prayer. Number 2, which is called takbiratul ihram, or the initial takbir, meaning saying Allahu Akbar, Allah is the greatest. Number 3, the third pillar of salah, to recite the opening chapter or surah of the Quran, which is called al-Faatihah. Number 4, which is called ar-ruku', or bowing. Number 5, coming up from the bowing position. Number 6, standing, meaning standing upright after you've done the bowing position. Number 7, to prostrate on 7 bones or 7 parts of your body. Number 8, coming up from or rising from the position of prostration. Number 9, you should sit between the two positions of prostration. Number 10, having very deep concentration, contemplation, peacefulness, sobriety, and tranquility while you're performing these acts of prayer. The 11th pillar of salah, or prayer, is to recite the final tashahhud. This may sound difficult to pronounce, and you'll meet many people, inshallah, if it's the will of Allah, who pronounce this incorrectly. They say tashahhud, but the correct pronunciation of it is at-tashahhud. Say it again. At-tashahhud. So the 11th pillar of salah, or prayer, is to recite the final tashahhud. Number 12, sitting while you're saying the final tashahhud. Number 13, or the 13th pillar of salah, or prayer, is called As-Salawatul Ibrahimiyya, or the prayer of Abraham. That is, to invoke or ask Allah's praise and blessings upon the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And the 14th pillar of salah is to make the taslimatani. At-taslimatani, or the two taslims. Number 1, if you have the ability to do so, then you have to stand when you're making the prayer. As for standing with the ability to do so, then the proof for this, or the evidence for this, is from the Quran, the book of Allah, and also from the statements of the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, called hadith or sunnah. Allah says in his book, وَقُومُوا لِلَّهِ قَانِتِينَ, and stand for Allah devoutly. And the Prophet Muhammad, in his hadith or from his sunnah, he said, صَلِّ قَائِمًا, pray standing. The second pillar, the initial takbir, or the takbir that commences the prayer, called takbiratul ihram. For that, we have the statement of the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and sometimes we can say, alayhi salam, may the salutations or peace be upon him. The Prophet said, then face the Qibla and make the takbir, which is to say, Allahu Akbar, Allah is the greatest. He also said that the takbir, or saying Allahu Akbar, when you begin the prayer, that is, makes everything impermissible for that prayer. As for the third pillar of salah, which is the recitation of Surah Al-Fatiha, then the Prophet Muhammad, alayhi salam, said, there is no prayer for the one who does not recite the Fatiha of the book, meaning the opening chapter of the Quran. Before we recite the Quran or read the Quran, we should or must say, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. I seek refuge with Allah from the accursed, rejected devil. Then we say, بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. In the name of Allah, the Beneficent, the Most Merciful. As for the Surah Al-Fatiha, it is the first surah in the Quran. Al-Fatiha is comprised of 7 ayat. Can you say this? Ayat. Ayat is the plural word of ayah. Right now, the meaning of ayah for you is verse. But as you go along in your studies of Islam, you will come to know that ayah has even more meanings. Surah al-Fatihah has 7 ayat or 7 verses. Repeat them after me. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. Maliki Yawmiddin. Iyaka na'budu wa iyaka nasta'in. اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. If you are not able to say this, and we pray to Allah that you will be able to say it, and say it correctly. If you can't say this in your prayers, then simply you will say, Alhamdulillah, La ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar. And that will be sufficient. But you must try, and you should try hard, to learn how to recite Al-Fatiha. Because as we've mentioned, you do not have a prayer if you're able to say it, if you do not recite the opening of the book. You should also keep in mind that this surah, Al-Fatiha, cannot be said in any other language except the Arabic language. And for this reason, as we've mentioned, our Prophet Muhammad, alayhi salam, has instructed us, those who are not able at the time, to recite Al-Fatiha properly or have some difficulty learning it, to say Alhamdulillah, all praise is due to Allah, La ilaha illallah, there is nothing worthy of worship as a deity except Allah, and finally, Allahu Akbar, Allah is the greatest. You should also remember that we're talking about right now the pillars of Salah. And a pillar in Islam is something that if it is omitted, if it is left out, then that entire act becomes null and void. It is an intricate part of that act of worship. Therefore, a pillar of the Salah, if it is missing, then the entire Salah is rendered void. So you must. All of us as Muslims, we must know what the pillars of Salah are, and we must maintain them and protect them and make sure that they are present in all of our acts of worship. As for the fourth pillar of Salah, this is bowing, or what is called ar-ruku'. Can you say this? Ar-ruku'. Ar-ruku'. Or bowing, the act of bowing, is when the person places his hands on his knees, his right hand on his right knee, and his left hand on his left knee. The palms of his hands with his fingers are grasping not so tightly and not so lightly his knees. Not on your thighs, and not on your shins, but rather on your knees. And you should try to make your back, as you're bowing, leveled with the floor. You shouldn't have your back bent up so high, nor your back and your head bent down so low. But rather, you should be straight, even with the floor. It is said that the Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, may the peace and blessings and praise of Allah be upon him, It is said that when he used to perform the ruku', this position, or the position of bowing to Allah in his salah, that his back and his head, his back was so straight that if you were to place water on his back, it would not move. Meaning, he didn't have his head and back up so high, nor down so low, but rather level, completely, perfectly level with the floor. And this is the way you should be performing your ruku', or your act of bowing. Number 5, coming up from the bowing position. That is standing upright, meaning when you come from the bowing position, you raise your head, you raise your back, and you stand upright. The Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, can you say that? Sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he said, Sallu kama ra'aytumuni usalli. Pray as you see me pray. So this means you should pray the way the Prophet Muhammad alayhi salam prayed. This means whether you are male or female. There are not that many differences between the worship of a man and a worship of a woman in Islam. In fact, the majority of the acts of Islam for the males and the females are the same. The vast majority. So if you are a listener and you're a woman, then you should pray the way the Prophet Muhammad alayhi salam prayed. And if you're a man, likewise, of course, you should pray the way the Prophet Muhammad alayhi salam prayed. So, when you're coming out of the position of ruku', or the bowing position, you should stand upright. And you're going to place your hands on your sides. Your right hand on your right side, and your left hand on your left side, as you normally stand when you're outside of the prayer. In these positions that we're mentioning, in these pillars of salah, there are some things, some supplications, some informal prayers that you're going to say and going to recite. You'll learn them on the CD, if it's the will of Allah, inshallah. Pillar number 6 is prostrating on 7 bones or 7 parts of your body. That is, that there are 7 parts of your body that must touch the floor, and those 7 parts of your body that must touch the floor, as we mentioned, are pillars of the salah. So this means you have to place your forehead, your nose, the palms of your hands, your knees, and the tips of your toes on the floor simultaneously. If you wear glasses, then remove them before you make the salah. Put them in your pocket in a safe place. And make sure that your forehead and your nose are both touching the floor. The forehead and the nose together as one bone. If your nose is not touching the floor, then this position of prostration called sujood. Can you say that? Sujood. Very good. If your sujood is not complete, then your prayer is not complete. And sujood, or the position of prostration, is the closest position that you will be in front of your Lord while you are praying. So it's very, very important. Like all the other aspects of Islam, sujood, or prostration, is very important. Remember not to allow your feet to be off the ground or off the floor. This is something that is not permissible while you're making the sujood or the position of prostration. Pillar number 7, is when you come from the position of prostration or sujood and you sit. Then the eighth pillar of salah is sitting between the two prostrations. So you have rising from the sujood, and you also have sitting between the two prostrations. And once again, in these positions, in each of these positions in the salah, there are going to be some things that you're going to say in glorification, magnification, praise of Allah, seeking forgiveness and the mercy of Allah for yourself and the other Muslims. So don't worry, you'll learn them very soon, inshallah, if it's the will of Allah. You sit, coming out of the position of prostration. Between the two positions of prostration, you will be sitting, and you will be saying something, inshallah. And the ninth pillar, then that is deep peacefulness, sobriety, tranquility, contemplation, concentration during all the acts of the prayers, from the standing position to the bowing position, returning from the bowing position, standing uprightly, going down to the prostration position, then coming from the prostration position and sitting between the two prostrations. All of these acts and all of these movements should be accompanied by peacefulness and tranquility and sobriety and contemplation and concentration. You should try your best to think about what you're going to be saying in each position and not to be too fidgety and moving around. Of course, there's going to be some movement because maybe you have to scratch or something like this. But try your best not to move as much as you can, because in your prayer, you are standing in front of Allah. You are standing in front of the Lord of the worlds, and you will be successful. As for the 10th pillar of salah, is the recitation of the final tashahud. Remember, it's not tashahud. It's pronounced tashahud. Can you say that? Very good. Tashahud. The tashahud is an important pillar of the salah. And when you say a tashahud, there are a lot of things that are involved in this prayer. Repeat the tashahud after me. You ready? Okay. التحيات لله والصلوات والطيبات السلام عليك أيها النبي ورحمة الله وبركاته السلام علينا وعلى عباد الله الصالحين أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. These words are beautiful. All compliments, prayers, and pure words are due to Allah. Peace be on you, O Prophet, and also the mercy of Allah and His blessings. Peace be on us and on the righteous slaves of Allah. I bear witness that none has the right to be worshipped except Allah, and I bear witness that Muhammad is His slave and messenger. This tashahud is said, as we've mentioned, in the final sitting of your prayers, and there are approximately 5 variations of this tashahud. So if you hear any Muslims who have been Muslims longer than you, saying it differently, don't be alarmed. Because, as we've mentioned, there are approximately 5 different variations or ways to say it. The next pillar is As-salatu ala nabi fi at-tashahhud al-akhir, which is invoking Allah's blessings and the praise of Allah upon the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the final tashahhud. This is done by saying Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad kama sallaita ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim innaka hamidun majid. Allahumma barik ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad kama barakta ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim innaka hamidun majid. O Allah, send prayers on Muhammad and on the family of Muhammad as you sent prayers on Ibrahim and on the family of Ibrahim. You are indeed worthy of praise, full of glory. O Allah, send blessings on Muhammad and on the family of Muhammad as you sent blessings on Ibrahim and on the family of Ibrahim. You are indeed worthy of praise, full of glory. We should mention that you should be very careful to not mispronounce the Prophet's name. His name is not pronounced Muhammad, but rather it is Muhammad. Muhammad. Can you say that? Try it. Muhammad. Not Muhammad. Nor is it pronounced Muhammad. Muhammad. But rather Muhammad. Do you hear the emphasis? Muhammad. Not Muhammad or Muhammad. It's very important to pronounce his name properly. The final pillar of Salah is At-Tasleem. At-Tasleem. This is to say, while turning your head to the right in the final sitting of your prayer, As-Salaamu Alaykum wa Rahmatullah. And then, turning your head to the left, you say, As-salamu alaykum wa rahmatullah. You will also hear some people saying, to the right, when they turn their heads, As-salamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. And then when they turn to the left, they will say, As-salamu alaykum wa rahmatullah, without the phrase wa barakatuh. You may also hear some people say, to the right, As-salamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. And then to the left, the same thing. As-salamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. All of these are correct, and all of these are from Islam and from the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We also want to tell you as a new Muslim, and definitely you will be successful, that when you turn your head to the right and you turn your head to the left, it's a simple matter. Just slightly turn your head where your face is directed toward the right and your chin is slightly above your shoulder. And the same thing to the left. You don't have to loop your head around in a circular motion, or as you're turning from the right to the left, stop facing the forward and then turn to the left, but rather just simply turn your head to the right. Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah to the right, and assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah to the left. A simple movement. When you do this, you will have ended your formal prayer. Once again, you will have ended, you will have completed your salah, your formal prayer. Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, wa khitamuha at-taslim, that the completion or the end is taslim, is saying assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah to the right, and saying assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi to the left. He also said wa tahliluha at-taslim, the thing that makes all things permissible again in the prayer is saying to the right and the left, assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah. As for the first wajib act in salah, then that is the saying of Allahu Akbar. This is apart from the first Allahu Akbar when you begin the prayer. In other words, when you say Allahu Akbar and you go to the ruku', or when you go to the sujood, to the bowing position and the position of prostration, you will be saying Allahu Akbar. That saying of Allahu Akbar is a wajib act. As for the very first Allahu Akbar, when you begin the prayer, then that is a pillar of the prayer. Is that understood? Very good. The second wajib act of the salah is at-tasmi', which is the statement, سَمِعَ اللَّهُ لِمَنْ حَمِدَهُ. Try that. سَمِعَ اللَّهُ لِمَنْ حَمِدَهُ. Allah hears those who praise him. And this will be said when the person, you, the new Muslim, may Allah bless you and continue to guide you and direct you towards his obedience. This will be said by you when you are rising from the position of ruku', or from the bowing position. You do not say Allahu Akbar when you're rising from the bowing position, but rather you say, سَمِعَ اللَّهُ لِمَنْ حَمِدَهُ. Allah listens to those who praise him. The third wajib or obligatory aspect of salah or prayer is التحميد, which is the statement, رَبَّنَا وَلَكَ الْحَمْدُ. رَبَّنَا وَلَكَ الْحَمْدُ. O our Lord, and to you is all types of praise. You are to say this after you say سَمِعَ اللَّهُ لِمَنْ حَمِدَهُ, when you're coming out of the position of bowing, and while you're standing upright, you say رَبَّنَا وَلَكَ الْحَمْدُ. You'll probably hear some Muslims saying it differently, because there are some other variations of this. No problem. رَبَّنَا, say it again, رَبَّنَا وَلَكَ الْحَمْدُ. Very good. The fourth wajib act or aspect of salah is while you're in the position of ruku' or bowing, you say, Subhana Rabbiyal Azim. Subhana Rabbiyal Azim. Again, Subhana Rabbiyal Azim. Glory to my Lord the Great, or glory to my Lord the Tremendous. Of course, once again, you say this while you're in the bowing position. And you're going to say it one time, which will be obligatory. Later on, you will learn that you can say it three times. But for now, it is obligatory to say this one time. Number five, or the fifth wajib act in the prayer, is while you're in the position of sujood, or the position of prostration, with those seven bones or seven parts touching the floor, the closest position that you will have in your prayer to Allah, you say, Subhana Rabbiyal A'la. Subhana Rabbiyal A'la. Can you say that? Try it. Subhana Rabbiyal A'la. It's pretty good, pretty good. You also say this one time. It is obligatory, wajib, to say this in the position of prostration one time. And like the ruku' with the other saying, you will learn later on that you can increase it to three times. But it is obligatory to say it one time. Number six, or the wajib act of salah, that is number six. While you're between the two prostrations and you're sitting, you say, Rabbir firli, Rabbir firli. This r sound is like a gargling sound. Rabbir, try it. Rabbir, like a gargling sound. Rabbir firli, firli, Rabbir firli. Pretty good. Oh, my Lord, forgive me. This is said one time, and it's obligatory to say it one time. But you'll learn later on that you can increase it to three times. But you have to say it one time. And there are other variations of this. There are other prayers like this between the two prostrations while you're sitting that the Prophet Muhammad alayhi salam gave us. Wajib act or aspect of salah number seven. At-tashahud al-awwal. At-tashahud al-awwal. And that is the first tashahud. This is when you will say, At-tahiyyatu lillah, was-salawatu, wat-tayyibatu. And we recited this for you and practiced this just some minutes ago. As for the eighth and final obligatory act of salah, then that is al-julus lit-tashahudil awwal. And that is to sit while reciting the first tashahud. This is an obligatory act because the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to do this all the time. He was vigil, constant on this. And the proof for this is his statement, Sallu kama ra'aytumuni usalli. Pray as you see me pray. As for the sunnah aspects of salah, then they are divided into two types, those of actions and those of statements. As for those of statements, then for instance, the opening supplication, when you begin the prayer after saying, Allahu Akbar, there are a variety, in fact, a wide variety of supplications or prayers that you can say after you open your prayer with Allahu Akbar. Also, after you've made one of those many types of opening prayers, you will say, A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytanir rajim, and you've already learned this. Also, saying, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim is also a sunnah aspect of salah. In addition, saying, Ameen, or as we mentioned, Ameen, either one of these two ways is correct. This is a sunnah of the prayer. Also, reciting a portion of the Quran, some ayat or some chapters of the Quran after al-Fatiha. Whatever you've learned since you've been a Muslim, may Allah bless you. Also, from the sunnahs of statements in your prayers are some other supplications. When you're coming out of the position of bowing or ruku', you can say, Mil as-sama'i wa mil al-ard. And you'll learn this later, inshallah. Also, saying, Subhana Rabbi al-Azim, more than one time, that is three times, when you're in the position of ruku' or bowing. Also, saying, Subhana Rabbi al-Azim, three times when you're in the position of ruku' or when you're bowing. And also to say, Subhana Rabbi al-A'la, when you're in the position of sujood or prostration. And there are other sunnah acts or sunnah statements that you can make in your prayer. As for the sunnahs of action, then they are raising the hands when you begin the prayer and say Allahu Akbar. Also, raising the hands when you go to ruku', to the bowing position, and when you come from the ruku', the bowing position. Also, placing your right hand on top of your left on your chest. And as we mentioned earlier, may Allah bless you and make you successful, for surely Islam is the religion of success. We mentioned to you that the prayer of the man and the prayer of the woman is the same. So placing your right hand on top of your left on your chest is for you, my brother in Islam, and you, my dear sister in al-Islam. These are all sunnah aspects of the prayer. Also, looking down with your head tilted slightly, looking, gazing at the position where your head is finally going to be when you're in prostration, is a sunnah act of the prayer. Placing your hands on your knees while you're in ruku' is a sunnah act of the prayer. Placing your hands on your thighs is also a sunnah act of the prayer. Having your back straight, level to the floor or the ground when you're in ruku' is also a sunnah act of the prayer. And there are others. So you see that the sunnah acts of the prayer are those things that shroud or adorn the wajib acts and the pillars of the prayer. May Allah bless you. Barakallahu fikum. You should also know, may Allah bless you, that before you offer your salah or your prayer, that you must be in a pure condition, that is clean. It's necessary to wash the parts of your body, which are generally exposed to things like dirt, grime, dust, smog, etc. This, as we mentioned earlier in the CD, is called wudu. Can you say that? Repeat after me. Wudu. Right. Wudu. This wudu is a wet ablution. In other words, you use water. There are six obligatory aspects or acts of wudu. The first one is washing the face, including the mouth and the nostrils. The second one is washing your hands up to the elbows. The third obligatory act of wudu is passing your wet hands over your head, and included in that is wiping your ears. The fourth obligatory act of wudu is washing your feet up to the ankle bones. Washing your feet up to your ankle bones. The fifth obligatory act of wudu or ablution is doing these things in the proper order. Doing them in the proper order of arrangement and sequence. And the final, the sixth and final obligatory act of wudu is observing some type of consistency or continuity between those acts of wudu, between the acts of wudu. There are some things that invalidate or make null and void your wudu. That is, if these things happen, you no longer are considered in an Islamic state of purity. You may be clean in general, but to perform the prayers, you will have to renew or perform again your wudu because your wudu has been invalidated. The invalidators of wudu are six. The first one is anything coming out of the two holes of your private parts, that is from the front and from the back. The second invalidator or canceller of wudu is anything that comes from the body that is deemed filthy or impure. Number three, if you were to fall unconscious, may Allah protect you from all that which is evil. If you were to fall into a state of unconsciousness, faint, or fall asleep and not know your surroundings for a while, or anything similar to this, this also breaks your wudu. It is a violator or invalidator of your wudu. Also, touching one's private parts, that is your own or someone else's private parts, that is your legal husband or your wife or something like this, to touch the private parts with desire is also a breaker of wudu. It's an invalidator of wudu. Number five, and this may sound silly or strange to you, because for the most part, you're probably from a part of the world where this doesn't exist. Eating camel meat, that's right, eating camel meat will break your wudu. And as you grow in your understanding of Islam, it will become clear why. If you were to eat a camel burger, it will break your wudu. Number six, and may Allah protect all of us from this, which is apostasy. That is, to go back to being a Christian, or to go back to being a Jew or a Hindu, or to go back to following Louis Farrakhan, or to be a 5%er, or anything like this, like an atheist. To leave Islam breaks the wudu. As we mentioned before about wudu being a wet ablution, there's another type of ablution that you as a new Muslim, barakallahu fiikum, may Allah bless you, you have to know how to do. And that ablution is more major for major things. It's called ghusl. Can you say that? Try it. Ghusl. There's that gargling sound again. Not ghusl, but ghusl. The ghusl is for major impurities, unlike wudu. Wudu is for minor impurities, like breaking wind, urinating, defecating, because the ghusl is for major impurities. For instance, when you have a wet dream, or you've been sexually active with your legal husband or wife, even if you don't have an orgasm or an ejaculation. Also, ghusl is for when a woman finishes or completes her menstrual cycle. When she's totally clean, she has to make a ghusl in order to make the salah. Likewise, when she has a baby, there is this bleeding, which they call postnatal bleeding or postpartum bleeding. She has to, when she finishes her bleeding, make a ghusl in order to make her salah. She cannot pray when she is bleeding. The easiest way for you to make the ghusl right now, until you become more knowledgeable in your Islam, may Allah bless you, is to simply take your hands and wash them without soap, then your left hand and wash your private parts. Then pour all the water on your head, covering your entire body 3 times. Of course, as we mentioned, there are other ways to perform this ghusl, but this should be sufficient for you right now. Barakallahu feekum. May Allah bless you. In closing, we'd like to say to you, our dear listener, the new Muslim, may Allah bless you, for surely you've become successful, is that there are a lot of things that you will have to know concerning your new deen, the religion of Islam, the religion that Allah chose for you to worship Him alone, with no partners. One of the things you should know is that you should try your best to stay close to the Muslims. Become acquainted with them and visit the masjid. Try to learn as much as you can about your Rabb, your Lord, Allah, the Most High, the Exalted, the Beneficent, the Merciful. Try to learn as much as you can about the Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. You should also try to learn the Quran and read it daily, even if it's only 5 minutes. Try to be true to your word. Keep your promises, even with the non-Muslims. Uphold your contracts. Be kind to people. Be a decent person, respectful to all. Also, you should try with everything that you have that Allah has given you to reflect upon death. For Allah, the Most High, has said in His book, كُلُّ نَفْسٍ ذَائِقَةُ الْمَوْتِ. كُلُّ نَفْسٍ ذَائِقَةُ الْمَوْتِ. Surely every soul shall taste of death. So you should try to think about your next life, and you should remember that that is going to come very soon. So be a good Muslim. Learn about your religion and spread what you have learned about your religion to others. If you are listening to this CD and you are non-Muslim, then we are inviting you to accept and embrace Islam, the true religion, the perfect way of life for you and all mankind. If you accept Islam, Allah has prepared for you in His paradise, His garden, in the next life, that which no eyes have ever seen, that which no ears have ever heard, nor the mind of a human being can ever conceive. In order to accept Islam, all you have to do is repeat after me. Say these words: Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. I bear witness that there is nothing worthy of worship as a deity except Allah, and I bear witness that Prophet Muhammad is the messenger of Allah. Have you said it? If you've said this sincerely from the bottom of your heart, then you are truly now a Muslim and you have become successful.
This has been an insight audio recording. All rights to this recording are reserved by Insight Audio. Insight Audio has now moved this audio to the Creative Commons license. Please download this audio, make copies of this audio, and redistribute this audio so that you can offer benefit to those around you. Thank you.
Insight Audio.